تبسم 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 تبسم.
Respected brothers and sisters in Islam, all thanks and praise due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through whose infinite grace and mercy we are gathered here on this noble day of Friday. Regarding this day, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had said, خَيْرُ يَوْمٍ طَلَعَتْ عَلَيْهِ الشَّمْسُ يَوْمُ الْجُمُعَةِ, that the best day upon which the sun rises is the day of Jumu'ah. There is no day in the Islamic week that is greater and more significant than the day of Friday. Suffice the greatness of this day in that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has informed us that in this day there exists such a time period, a sa'ah, a period of time, that if a person asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of anything which is permissible in this particular time span, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will definitely grant him whatever he asks for. So over and above everything else that we might do and busy ourselves with on a Friday, it is very important that we single out some time to supplicate, to raise our hands and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for those things which we require. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises on the tongue of his beloved Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that there is such a time on a Friday that when you raise your hands in supplication, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant you whatever you ask for. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability to look out for this time and to spend this time in supplicating towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so that our supplications may be answered. This day of Friday, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam further informs us that a person who attends the Jummah on a Friday and then he attends the next Jummah, simply by him presenting himself in a Jummah, all his minor sins which he may have committed between the Jummahs, all those sins are forgiven. This is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as we will see later on, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala time and time again provides us this opportunity of forgiveness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to forgive us. But a little more about that later inshallah. So we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for bringing us together on this day of Friday. And then not only has he brought us together on this day of Friday, he has brought us together in this most beloved place in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the masjid. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said that the most beloved place in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are the masajid, those places in which the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioned, those places in which the name of his beloved messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is taken. This is the best place in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the worst place are the marketplaces. And we do not have to explain why the marketplaces are the worst places. It is for obvious reasons. So we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for bringing us together on a Friday. And furthermore, he has brought us together in this most noble place, which is the masjid. And above that, we are not gathered here in the masjid to discuss any politics. We are not gathered here in the masjid to discuss any extramural activities. We are not here in the masjid to discuss business, but rather we are here in the masjid to engage ourselves and busy ourselves in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Such is the virtue of such a gathering that not only the active participants of this gathering, but that person who maybe happened just to pass this gathering. You know, imagine a person wanting to come in from the one door and he goes out by the other door. Or somebody may be coming into the gathering, he doesn't intend to sit here. He simply wants to get something from somebody who happens to be in this gathering. Even that person will be affected by the magnitude and the greatness of this gathering. All the active participants will be forgiven, as well as that person who just happened to be in the gathering, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive him as well. So as we continue with our talk today, I want you to keep these two things in mind, these two examples. It is examples. The one Jummah to the next Jummah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is prepared to forgive your sins. When you enter into such a gathering, You may not be an active participant, but still to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is prepared to forgive your sins. So we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for these blessings. And we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for granting us the ability to attend such gatherings and to attend the Jumu'ah. This is only through the grace and mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. About the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has many qualities. We are quite familiar with the 99 names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But of these many qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we mention the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the first of his qualities that comes to mind is this quality of rahmah. So therefore, when we begin anything, we begin with Bismillah. So we say Bismillah. As we are saying Bismillah, that I begin in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we mention Allah's name, the first of his qualities that come to mind is Ar-Rahmanir Rahim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. I begin in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is most merciful, most beneficent. And then when you really think about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has these qualities, who has these qualities of mercy, who has these qualities of beneficence, then what do we say? Alhamdulillah. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And who is this Allah? Rabbil Alameen. He is the Lord of the entire universe. Now if you think about it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of his salient qualities, one of his most outstanding qualities, is this quality of rahmah. He is the Lord of all the worlds, but despite that, he is still a Lord of mercy. You and me, if we were to be put in a position of authority, irrespective of whether we qualify for that position or not, what happens is that we become arrogant. We're given any position of authority, we assume the position irrespective of whether we are qualified for that position or not, and then automatically what happens is when we settle in that position, we develop a certain degree of arrogance. It is like the expression of the Holy Quran, where some of the wrongdoers, they would say, إِنَّمَا أُوتِيتُهُ عَلَىٰ عِلْمٍ. I was given this based on my own expertise, based on my own ability. That is why I've been given this. But if Allah, he's the Lord of the worlds, but yet he's Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. This position which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has as Lord of the entire worlds, whatever of kingdom that we can see and we cannot see, قُلِ اللَّهُمَّ مَالِكَ الْمُلْكِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala owns the entire kingdom. تُؤْتِ الْمُلْكَ مَنْ تَشَى. That you will give this kingdom to whomsoever you wish. وَتَنْزِعُ الْمُلْكَ مِمَّنْ تَشَى. And you take this kingdom away from whomsoever you wish. تُعِزُّ مَنْ تَشَى وَتُذِلُّ مَنْ تَشَى. That you will grant honor to whomsoever you wish. You will degrade and you will debase whomsoever you wish. This great Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he still has this quality of Ar-Rahman. He is most merciful. So much so that the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is something which cannot be contained. The mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encompasses everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself, in explaining this quality of himself, he says, وَرَحْمَتِي وَسِعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. وَرَحْمَتِي, my mercy, وَسِعَتْ, it has encompassed, it has covered كُلَّ شَيْءٍ, everything. Whatever you can think of in terms of creation, and you witness this, you will find this element of mercy on there. Whether it be in a child, whether it be in an adult, whether it be from amongst mankind, whether it be from jinnkind, whether it be from simple creation, whatever you will take out the time and ponder over this thing, you will find this element of mercy in this particular thing. The wildest of animals, the most vicious of animals, in those animals too you will find this element of mercy. وَرَحْمَتِي وَسِعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. That my mercy has encompassed everything. Those angels responsible for carrying the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, الَّذِينَ يَحْمِلُونَ الْعَرْشَ وَمَنْ حَوْلَهُ يُسَبِّحُونَ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّهِمْ وَيُؤْمِنُونَ بِهِ وَيَسْتَغْفِرُونَ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Those who are carrying the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يُسَبِّحُونَ بِحَمْدِ. They praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They sing and they laud the praises of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As a matter of fact, every given entity praises Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The only thing is that we not understand how these things praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَإِن مِّن شَيْءٍ إِلَّا يُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِهِ وَلَكِنْ لَا تَفْقَهُونَ تَسْبِيحَهُمْ. Everything, every given thing, animate or non-animate, that thing sings the praises of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but لَا تَفْقَهُونَ تَسْبِيحَهُمْ. You don't know how they praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these angels, they believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And over and above that, once again, this point which I mentioned earlier on, this aspect of ghufran, they seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for who? For those who believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they say to Allah, oh Allah, رَبَّنَا وَسِعْتَ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ رَحْمَةً وَعِلْمًا. Oh Allah, you have encompassed everything. وَسِعْتَ, you have surrounded everything. You have enveloped everything in what? رَحْمَةً وَعِلْمًا, in mercy and knowledge. The mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't go past anything. The knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't go past anything. This is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to illustrate further, that even if we wanted to contain the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you wouldn't be able to contain the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Once, a Bedouin. Now a Bedouin is a countryside dweller. And you have to understand that the Arab community was basically broken up into city dwellers and countryside dwellers. City dwellers and Bedouins. Now the Bedouins were very rough-edged, rough and ready. Some of the Bedouins would come into the presence of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and because they stay out in the countryside and they're rough and ready, they would say to him, Ya Muhammad, O Muhammad. They would address him like they would address anybody else. Not because they were being rude, but simply because that's their nature. They have a hard nature, rough nature. So one of the Bedouins came into Medina and he prayed the Salah with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And after the Salah, he got onto his camel and before leaving, he said, Allahumma arham Muhammad. Allahumma arham Muhammad. Allahumma arhamni wa Muhammad. وَلَا تَرْحَمْ سِوَانَا فِي مَعْنَى الْحَدِيثِ. He says, oh Allah, have mercy on me, have mercy on Muhammad, and don't have mercy on anybody else. Exclusive. Grant me your mercy, grant Muhammad your mercy, and don't worry about the rest. And if we look now in terms of the progression of our talk today, we found that we've come here from last week to this week, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forgiven all our minor sins. We find ourselves in a gathering in which we are mentioning the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Just by sitting here, leave alone the active participants of this gathering, that person who simply just happens to pass this gathering, his sins will also be forgiven. So these are all opportunities that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to forgive us. And if you look at it from another angle, it is as follows. That which man requires, that which is imperative, that which is necessary for the existence of man, the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that He provides that in abundance. The rule is that whatever man requires for his subsistence, for his existence, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides that in abundance. Let's look at an example. You might be able to go without a roof over your head. You might be able to survive without clothes on your body. You might be able to go without water for without food for a few days. You might be able to survive for a day or two without water. But air, oxygen, is something which you cannot survive without. If you are cut off from a supply of oxygen for a half a minute, you might live. A minute, you might live. 2 minutes, 3 minutes, 4 minutes, let's say 5 minutes at the most, you might live. But if you are cut off from your supply of oxygen for more than 5 minutes, it's going to result in your inevitable death. You're going to die. So oxygen is such a thing which you need and you must have in order to survive. And therefore Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides it. Everybody needs oxygen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives each and every single person an equal supply of oxygen. And there's no price to it. At least up until now, they haven't figured out to put a price onto it. But there's no price onto air. And to a lesser degree, we can look at a phenomenon like water. Yes, water has been bottled. You can buy water now. But by and large, water is such a commodity which is freely available. Actually, in the creation of the earth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made that two-thirds of the earth that we live in is water. It might be salt water, but this assists in the process of rain, the process of evaporation. The greater the surface area, the greater amount of evaporation can take place, and the greater amount of rain that can be sent down. So the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has facilitated for water, which is such a great need for man in such a great way, tells us and supports this principle which we have established, that if mankind needs something, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides for that particular thing in great measure. So we've seen the example of air. We've seen the example of how wonderful it is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates the supply of water. In many, many verses of the Holy Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about how He facilitates for the sending down of rain. Allahu alladhi yursilu ar-riyah fayabsutuhu fi as-samaa'i kayfa yasha wa yaj'aluhu kisafan fatara al-wadqa yakhruju min khilali wa yunazzilu min as-samaa'i ma yasha ila akhir al-ayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about how He sends the wind clouds to come together. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through His mercy and wisdom, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala scatters some of the clouds in the skies. Some Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stacks upon each other. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala causes the rain to come down from these clouds. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala causes the earth to become nourished through these rains. This is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So water we need, Allah supplies us abound. Air we need, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala supplies it in volume. But that's all on the physical side. In terms of our spiritual needs, what do we need? Man, by our nature, we tend to err. We tend to make a mistake. It is said in a narration that the first of man made a mistake and he erred, referring to Adam alayhi salam. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered him not to go close to a certain tree, then the devil deceived him and had him partake of that particular tree. So man, Adam alayhi salam, and man by extension, by their very nature, they forget, they err, they make mistakes. كل بني آدم خطاؤون وخير الخطائين التوابون. That all of the sons of Adam alayhi salam, they make mistakes. You will inevitably make a mistake. Nobody is perfect. Only the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, are infallible. They don't make mistakes. But you and I, we have a tendency to make mistakes. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows this, and He knows our nature. So like our physical need, there's a need to supply us with water. There's a need to supply us with air. In the same way, to see to our spiritual needs, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates a certain facility. And that is the facility of forgiveness. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, time and time again, as we've seen by the examples, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to forgive us. Allah knows that we need to be forgiven. Like Allah knows we need water. Like Allah knows we need air. Spiritually, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows we need forgiveness. Therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at every given opportunity, He wants to forgive us. So therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created these seasons. The first season, the example which we mentioned, was the season of Ramadan. All of us know that. All of us try and benefit optimally to benefit from the month of Ramadan. But that is not the only spiritual season. The spiritual season of a Muslim doesn't only come once a year, but rather the spiritual season, if we really look at it, for those people who gain closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, every day contains so many times and so many opportunities for us to spiritually benefit and gain closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the spiritual season which I'd like to point out is the spiritual season which we find ourselves in today, and which our respected Sheikh had alluded to last week, that we find ourselves in the spiritual season of Hajj. This Hajj is not only relevant to those who are going to Makkah to perform Hajj, but rather that Hajj is relevant to each and every person. It's not only a spiritual season for those people who are fortunate enough, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all the efforts. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give them a Hajj maqabool and mabroor. May Allah give them a good Hajj. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make them return to us, and they're in such a spiritual state, like the day that their mother gave birth to them. Like they are totally free, like a newborn baby, free of all sins. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give them that. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant them that they also make dua istighfar for us as well. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, forgive that person, that haji who makes dua of forgiveness, and forgive that person for whom the haji makes dua for as well. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by extension include us in that as well. So we find ourselves in this great spiritual season. And allow me to say this, respected brothers in Islam, that this spiritual season, in terms of importance, and in terms of spirituality, and important of significance, is no less than the spirituality of the month of Ramadan. The spirituality of this season which we find ourselves in is no less than the spirituality and the significance of the month of Ramadan. So much so that Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala an has reported in the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam that there are no actions more beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than those actions which are performed in the first 10 days. Now what do those first 10 days refer to? In another narration, the narrator explains, those first 10 days, it refers to the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. There is no action performed at any other time of the year, which includes the days of the month of Ramadan, which is more significant and greater than the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. So now, you might be taken aback. I was always led to believe that of all the months of the lunar calendar, that the month of Ramadan is the most significant month. Yes, the nights of the month of Ramadan is much more significant than any other nights. And specifically so, the last 10 nights of the month of Ramadan, because it contains that night of power, that night of Laylatul Qadr. And because of that, the last 10 nights of the month of Ramadan is more significant than any other 10 nights in the entire year. However, the first 10 days, the key word being days, the first 10 days of the month of Dhul Hijjah are more significant than any other day. This is an opportunity. And then the companions, like you, might be surprised. They were also surprised. And they said to the Prophet ﷺ, O Prophet of Allah, since we are talking about these spiritual seasons, and since we're talking about these spiritual times of the year and these spiritual actions, what about jihad fi sabilillah? If you are saying that no action is more significant than an action performed in these first 10 days, what about at any other time of the year if somebody strives in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, What did he answer? What do you expect him to answer? You expect him to say, okay, that's an exception. But no. He says, وَلَا الْجِهَادِ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. Not even fighting in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at any other time of the year can outweigh the significance of a good action performed in the first 10 days of the days of the Hijjah. Subhanallah. Except, he does make a provision. Except for that person who strives with his life and his wealth in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he doesn't return. Neither does he return with his wealth and neither does he return with his life. Only the action of that person, that ultimate sacrifice, can outweigh the significance of an action performed in the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. This is what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say in the Holy Quran? If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to point out the significance of a given thing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes an oath. وَالضُّحَى, by the morning light. وَالتِّينِ وَالزَّيْتُونَ, Allah talks about the significance of the olive and the fig. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَالنَّجْمِ إِذَا هَوَى, Allah talks about, takes an oath by the stars. Allah points out the significance. Allah takes another oath and he says, وَالْفَجْرِ وَلَيَالٍ عَشْرٍ. He takes an oath by these 10 nights. These 10 days the Mufassirun say refer to what? It refers to the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. So respected listeners, our message today, when I was preparing the talk, I was thinking to myself that this might be premature. We are only in Dhul Qa'dah. There's about plus minus 15 days left for Dhul Hijjah. This is very premature, this talk. It is not premature. Like we plan our monthly planner, our weekly planner, and our daily planner, if you really want to benefit from the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah, you have to start planning from now. When you get home, you have to take out your diary and say, look, when does the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah fall? Is it possible for me, like in the month of Ramadan, to maybe take leave for 1 or 2 days? Is it possible for me to maybe fast 1 or 2 days? Is it possible maybe for me to take out time and spend in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to do some community service, for me to do some good work, to me to be of some assistance, to me to help out my Muslim brothers? We must all plan for this, inshallah. Take out our diaries. Look at when the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah form and plan, inshallah, and in that way, the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah will be fruitful, bi-idhnillah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَلِوَالِدَيَّ وَلِوَالِدِيكُمْ وَلِسَائِرِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ مِنْ كُلِّ ذَنْبٍ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوا إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ.